first question. If you could change your name to anything, what would you change it to?
I wouldn't change it.
You wouldn't change it? Okay, that's a good answer. How about you, Oliver?
Jackson.
You change just from Oliver to Jackson?
Cristiano Ronaldo.
So, but just the name, you wouldn't have his talent. So those of you who don't know who that is, he's a famous musician.
Player.
I mean, soccer player, yes.
Princess of the Sea?
Princess of the Sea, from now on, that's who this is. What would you change your name to?
James?
I mean, these are just normal names. You need
Cristiano is a normal name.
Well, in his area. How about you, Chloe?
Donut.
Donut? You change your name to Donut? You can change your name to anything. What would you name it to? Clark. There you go. That's a... Next question. What is the biological basis of consciousness?
Not thinking.
Good.
Self-consciousness.
Self-consciousness is probably a good answer.
Kindness.
Kindness is the biological basis of consciousness. That's good.
I don't understand your question.
The biological basis of consciousness, what is it? How about you?
I have no idea what any of that means.
Your brain stops. See? Oliver's tracking.
I'm only a second grader.
If you could have any superpower, what would it be?
Probably protecting demons. Nah.
What? You changed your mind instantly. Probably protecting demons. No. I don't even know why I said that. If you could ask God anything, what would you ask him?
What's heaven like?
What's heaven like? That's a
good
question.
Probably.
Yeah, same question. Are you saying that just because you can't come up with your own?
No, yeah. I would probably ask that.
Yeah.
For wisdom?
For wisdom? You just ask him for wisdom? That's good.
Can you make me fly? I really wanna.
Yeah, that'd be awesome, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Princess of the Sea flies and swims in the ocean. The sea. What do you need wisdom about?
All right. Well, welcome, everybody. How's everybody doing today? Good? All right. Well, we are in the last week of the series that we're doing right now called Questions. And at the 9:30 service, somebody texted me in the middle of the service and asked me a really good question. They asked me if I knew that our giant screen was out. And I was like, yes, I am aware of that. So we do have magnification in the back, in the middle. On the side where I've been pointing for a long time, and then we have this thing up here. So yeah, it's a little bit different, but it's gonna be great. Before we get into this today, we have something called Become at 1 o'clock at the church office. Joel talked about this last week. This used to be kind of our membership course, and we're just not really using that language anymore. But it is the chance that you get to come and you get to learn about what this church is. And so I think this is fitting for a series like Questions because we're talking about a lot of things that we believe, the way that we think, the way that we say things, and it might be new for some people, and so you might want to know, like, well, I wonder why their services look like that. I wonder why they do this. I wonder why they talk like that. I wonder why they worship like that. And so this is a great opportunity to come and learn all of those things about what it looks like to be in the family of 514 Church and its community. You have anything to add?
Maybe one of the questions would be like, why is the hazer still on?
Yeah, it's a little hazy up here.
It is, man. I feel like we're like presenting in a cloud from the heavens. You got me. Thank you.
Thanks, Kevin.
Sorry. Just, we can't see anyway up here, so that adds another layer of, it's like John and I just sitting in a room talking with microphones on.
But it's smoky for some reason. So it's weird.
Yeah.
All right. Well, why don't we get going? This last week, we want to tackle a few questions. You know, like I said last week, we got 50, 60 questions from everybody. And so we have been trying to answer in a broad stroke, like what big themes, things that repeated themselves. And so if you have a specific question that didn't get answered from stage, if you submitted it, it was anonymous, and so there's no way for us to reach out to you and answer that question. But if you really want to know the answer to something specific that we haven't got to, there are these Connect cards under your seats, and you can write that down, give us a way to contact you. We would love to have a conversation with you or sit down with you about your specific question. That's how we hope to go about answering everybody's questions, but it's kind of up to you guys at this point to reach out to us and let us do that. As we kind of go into today, we want to talk a little bit more about the way that we're approaching these questions, you know, why we feel comfortable wrestling with these questions the way that we do, and why we think it's okay that we have a diverse group of people who believe different things about different topics. And so I've asked Joel if he could read something for everybody real quick.
This is the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
All right. All right, so that is called the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed. And so, depending on what denomination you came from or you've been a part of in your life, you might know that creed better than others. But what's interesting about the creeds is the reason that they were created. Like, why is that something that Christians know? And one of the things that's important for us to understand about church history is the way that the church started to spread was very organic and very quick. And so within 100 years after Jesus' death, you had a movement that started in Jerusalem in the Middle East that went all the way up to modern-day Turkey, all the way down to Alexandria, Egypt, and into Ethiopia, all the way to the east, they think, into India, and then all the way into the west to Athens, and then past that into Italy and Rome. And all of this was happening without a central structure, without any sort of central governance that's telling people what they are and aren't to believe. They had letters, they had the Old Testament, and they had the apostles witness, and they had missionaries who were going and teaching these things. And so with that being the case, one of the first things that's going to happen is there's going to start to be a diversity of beliefs about what this means and how you practice what you believe and what you're supposed to do. And so as soon as the early church came out from the persecution of the Roman Empire and they were allowed to be this real entity, they started to have these councils. And one of the first things that the council started to do is they started to create these creeds. And a creed is essentially what we call the basis of Christian orthodoxy. And orthodoxy just means proper or normative belief. And so essentially what these creeds were designed to do was, amongst the diversity that happened in this church because of how far it spanned and how quickly it spread, the creeds create a border of what it means to profess to be a Christian. What does it mean to be a Christian? What do you believe when you're a Christian? And the creeds create the foundation of this. So I believe in God the Father, the creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus, who is a historical person, who suffered under a historical governor, who died and resurrected from the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who is with us, who indwells us now. I believe in the physical bodily resurrection is where we as Christ followers are all headed. I believe in the Holy Catholic, which means universal church, the church body of believers across the world. And I believe in the forgiveness of sins. And this is what it looks like to be a Christian. And one of the reasons we want to talk about this today is because as we go through some of these questions, as we've gone through some of these questions, what's interesting about the way that the church fathers created orthodoxy or belief was all of the things that they didn't talk about. All the things that they didn't talk about, right? When you look in the middle here of this outline, so if this establishes the borders or the boundaries of Christianity, there's all kinds of controversial topics on the inside, topics that are hot-button issues that these creeds and these fathers didn't specifically address. And so one of the things that we want this community of people to embrace is the idea that when we talk about these things, when we debate these things, when you learn new information about these things, when your beliefs about these things start to change or shift, you are not committing some sin of moving outside of the bounds of Christianity. You're not. Think about what the apostles wanted us to understand in this creed. They wanted us to understand the border and the outline. And so, you know, this is interesting as a church community how you go about this, because Joel's going to talk a little bit about the way that sometimes we set it up so that every single issue is an issue that we live or die for, that we break fellowship for.
Yeah, one of the things that we've always taught, and as we're answering questions with this kind of discussion and illustration, We didn't come up with this so that we could figure out a way to answer questions. This is the way that I have led, John, our team has led this church since the very beginning, and it's this idea of hierarchy. You see, what you could also look at this like is like a pyramid, and the things on the outside are the foundation of the pyramid. And that's the basis of our faith, that they're never going to change. And I had a professor once say, you need to set your theology up that way, because if you don't, you'll do it another way, which most of us do, and that is with a domino idea. Because what we're wrestling through with this is a very, it can get philosophical. We're talking about what is true. And like John mentioned in the last service, there are things about some of these issues that we believe if you interpret correctly, which we're not saying we have interpreted them all correctly, but that are more right or wrong. So there are some things in here that we think, man, the Bible really does reveal this, but if you set your theology up, like, for example, if you have an idea about the rapture, like a domino, if you set it up like a domino, you have an idea about the rapture and you believe that there's a real physical rapture like left behind, like in some moment we're just going to get snatched away and disappear and our clothes are going to be left, and that's like kind of the picture of this. If you believe in that and then you learn something that maybe it's not that way, maybe that's not what Paul was saying. If you set your faith up like dominoes, then that truth is just as fundamental as the resurrection. And then so goes the rapture theology, so goes resurrection, domino, your whole faith can go away. But really what we're saying is there are lots of ideas here. They're the top of the pyramid. Move them around, discover, ask questions. There's a bunch of gorgeous answers to some of these ideas. Let's not get stuck on it has to be like this. And what happens in the church is that idea of dogma. I believe in Jesus, and because that's so fundamental, the historical Jesus. I mean, when John talks about history, the whole church was started without books being written, based on an event of a man raising from the dead, and they just went out and told that story. And then other ideas came in, so they had to like say, this is the foundation, this is what the message is. And churches started based upon some of these different ideas or nuances or perspectives. But it doesn't mean that you're not the church if you don't agree on infant baptism. And so it's so important as we talk about these things to understand that there are churches who live within the pale of orthodoxy that have different views on worship style. I mean, look, some people believe that worship style should be more liturgical. You believe that there's this reverence that you know, that Kevin's holes in his jeans and Eddie jumping up and down, that's like, that's not right. And so you might go down the street to a place that worships differently, and that's fine. We don't think we're more right or less right or all those different ideas. You can go there and worship, but it still means we're in the family. It still means we're in the church universal. And what I said last service, which is so important, and I want to say this very softly, but if you look at some of these things, for example, politics is an easy one, and you go, I believe, you know, in specific ideas, and if the church that I'm at or someone doesn't agree with me politically, like if they don't vote Republican, then you actually break fellowship with them. I know for a fact that there's half the people in this room who don't agree with me on politics. We did the test. 50% of the room votes one way, 50% of the room votes the other. I believe if in your mind there's only one way to vote on politics and you can like break fellowship from someone and you actually question some of these things about them if they don't agree on that, I would call that a lack of maturity. And I say that with just all humility. I'm not saying that you're not fully mature in other areas, but in your perspective of what this is all about, you have decided to major on minors. And we believe that the Bible, the creeds, the faith is very loud about these things. Very loud. We believe Paul's description with the word that he uses one time or whatever, rapture, we believe that's kind of quiet. And we think sometimes people turn the volume up on these to eclipse the importance of these. Whenever that is happening, we think that's immature. We think that you're missing something. These things right here caused literal denominations and schisms and factions all throughout church history because people would just, they had this idea of this thing and they would break fellowship from other places just because they had a different interpretation of one part of the Bible, but they agree on more than they disagree upon. It's immaturity. It's missing it. You'll notice people who have a mature, balanced faith. They can sit and talk with someone about something like rapture or worship or infant baptism or communion. I mean, I have great friends who partake in the Catholic tradition every single week. They believe something totally different happens during communion. And I do not think that they are like these horrific people. I think they're wonderful, beautiful people that have a different take on things. I believe that's maturity, and that's why we want you to know.
And in the family of God.
They're in the family of God, that there are people on our staff that have different ideas about this. I know everybody wants to know this one. What do we think? What does 514 Church say about this? Look, we can talk about that. I have strong opinions on certain pieces of it. On certain pieces of it, I have no clue what to tell you. No clue what to tell you. So why would I do that? Because if I go pick something, I may push someone out of the family of God. We want to teach what the scriptures say. We want to do the best to rightly divide the word of truth. But we have to be careful to be loud where it's loud, to be soft where it's soft, and then really to be silent where it's silent. And that's what happens. So many people have theologies that are based on a very scary deductive reasoning where they kind of move down a logical thought because the scriptures say something, and then it stops saying something, and they draw some conclusion in the dark. Scary way to set your theology up. Notably, this is not just in a church context, not in the church global, not just in local, but also in a relationship like a marriage. Isn't it true? I mean, so many of us have spouses that believe different things about this. I mean, and the concept is transcendent, right? You're going to agree on the majors. You married this person. You're going to disagree on gluten-free or whatever else it is. I mean, it's just the concept transcends. We have to learn to think this way about most things in life, in my opinion.
Yeah, absolutely. And just to clarify, before we move on and actually talk about a specific topic, we want to be very clear that we do think that these things on the inside of the box are really important.
Yes.
And we think that you can have a correct or a good interpretation of them, and we think you can have a bad or an incorrect interpretation of them. And obviously what we struggle to do all the time is to make sure that what we are teaching and preaching has good biblical understanding and legs behind it. Because these things are important, you know? I mean, they really are. We did this on Tuesday night at the beginning. But an analogy would be, you know, when you're in a car, I'm driving, and you're sitting in the passenger seat, and I think that there's a right way for you to sit in that seat. I think you should sit with your butt in the seat and your back against the backrest, and I think you should buckle in because safety first, all right? But what happens if you unbuckle and you kick your feet up on my dashboard? Well, are you still in the car? Yes. Do I think that's the best way to sit in my car? No. Take your feet off my dashboard. They're dirty, right? I don't want that there. But what if you did something even more extreme and you laid the seat down flat and then you laid on your stomach with your head facing the window? You're still in the car, right? I think that's a dangerous way to sit in the car, and you will probably die if I get in an accident, right? You could get up on the dashboard, and now it's dangerous because I can't see, but you are still in the car, right? You're still in the car. That's kind of what we're talking about here. Those things are important. They matter, but you're still in the car. Now, one of the best movie scenes of the last 10 years is Lady Bird. The mom is chirping at the daughter, and they're driving. And as she's, you know, picking at the daughter, she opens the door and she just rolls out, right? That is, now you're no longer in the car, right? That's the idea of some of these
and
majors.
And to be honest, to take that analogy a little further, the Lady Bird example, when we get really heavy-handed about particular things, even these things, bedside manner, the way we interact with one another on all of it can play a role in whether or not someone stays in the car.
Yeah.
Now, to add to the, there are brilliant people that are four times smarter than John and I combined that have different opinions on some of these things. And so we're doing the best that we can do. We respect other people. Some of you may be John Piper people. Some of you may be N.T. Wright people. Some of you may have just totally different somewhere in between. All fine. I had a conversation this week with a wonderful man who's been coming to our church for over a year, and he heard my teaching on the rapture. And he looked me right in the face and said, I think you're wrong. And I said, well, then you can buy the coffee, sucker. And no, he said he thought I was wrong. And I said, that's okay. I said, everything that you're saying, when I was in school, that's what they taught me. And I have learned and learned some other stuff, and I'm interpreting it differently now. But this man, and this is I won't tell you what his name is, but he deserves so much respect because he has been giving to our church and knowing that he doesn't fully agree with some of these other pieces. But yeah. He's like, I know we agree on all the majors and all that stuff and what's going on here. That, to me, is maturity. You are going to, and John will speak to this, you are going to disagree. And that's beauty. That's uniformity?
Unity without uniformity.
Without uniformity. Like, yeah. We don't want this place to be full of people that all believe the exact same things. Right. You said something. Say that again.
Yeah, always be careful when you find yourself in a community where everybody thinks all the same things as you, because you're not ever going to grow. You might be comfortable, but you're not ever going to grow. And so, you know, what Joel has created here is a culture, and the people here have created a culture where we can talk about these things with curiosity and bravery, because we know that these aren't the things that make or break our faith. I am not a child of God because I have the right interpretation of infant baptism. I'm a child of God because of the foundations of here and what Jesus did for me in his death and resurrection. And so that means that all the different opinions that people have about this, that's not scary. That's interesting. I want to know why. I'm curious. I want to know how this brilliant scholar came up with this interpretation and this brilliant scholar came up with a different interpretation. I want to, like, move into that and push into that tension, because whatever the truth is about that, it's important, but it doesn't make or break the fact that I am a child of God. It doesn't make or break the fact that you're a child of God. And so when we talk about these things, when we start to wrestle with questions, that is the mindset that we have to have. That's why sometimes it's important to go back to the early fathers and understand how they set up the hierarchy of theology and belief. And we don't have to knock the dominoes down because of something in the middle.
And if someone chooses, people have come to the church, they've heard what we think, they go down the street, they feel afraid to run into me at Kroger, and that's the last thing they need to do. Because I could not, and in fact, I respect it. I respect if someone feels something different or thinks something that we may not emphasize.
Yeah.
I totally respect that. One of the things to just be aware of is this idea of dogma and this idea that, you know, the domino idea. We're supposed to preach the gospel, and that has gotten kind of, that's made its way into the last 100 years in this very intense, expressive, you need to know Jesus and you can give your life to Jesus and da da da. And so it gets preached, it gets emphasized, it's punchy, right? Especially 100 years ago when they didn't have, you know, TV, and it's like they'd stand up and you preach, and so what happens is that tone, that way, that mechanism for communicating and that intensity of dogma around fundamentals, oftentimes that same approach to information gets brought to non-essentials. And so you kind of hear something and you go, well, that sounds just as important. And then again, you throw the baby out with the bathwater if one of them breaks away. That is one of the things you have to be able to be wise and look through and go, you know, churches are going to, in the grace of God, pick some of these non-essentials at times, and we even do it. We'll pick them and preach them like they're gospel, like they're just as intense because we're making a point or we're emphasizing something at a time. But when you step back, you have to be able to see it in this hierarchical idea that God has foundational principles and truths that are transcendent, and then move on from there and be curious and engage in community.
Yep. And you're not being unfaithful by wrestling with these concepts. You're not. You're actually being intellectually curious, which is an important part of our faith. So in terms of, like, you know, we talked about this one last week, heaven and hell. It might have been a new way to think about it, maybe a little bit different than what you grew up with or what you've heard, you know, Christian culture speak. And so one of the things that we want to touch on today is why that's important. You know, why the things that we're saying is not just to shake things up. It's because we think it really matters. And so I want to open with just an example. Okay, so I grew up just north of Columbus, Olentangy, Lewis Center. And I went to school at Xavier University in Cincinnati. And so to get to Xavier, you get on 71 off of Polaris, and you just drive straight south, and then you get to Xavier. It's a very easy drive. As you leave Columbus, you go past Grove City. I think you go past Frank Road. And then there's a big sign on the road, a big billboard. Somebody paid for a billboard as you go down to Cincinnati, and it says, if you died today, where would you go? Where would you go? How does that speak to the way that the Christian culture has kind of summarized the gospel?
Yeah, this is one of those ones that when you start talking about the gospel, the good news is what the word is. The good news, it's kind of the embodiment of all these fundamentals. And then the gospel preaching moves into this style. But when we talk about information, one of the things that I'm so passionate about is we called this section de-weaponizing the gospel. Because for so long, that idea, the billboard idea, the question when you go to the youth conference, if you died tonight, hey, forget everything we're saying, forget everything about Jesus, forget everything, whatever. If you died tonight, where would you go? That is a question that lives in an idea, in a broad idea of what it means to accept Jesus, what heaven is, what hell is, that we believe strongly does not fit the holistic narrative of what it means to be in this relationship that we have with God. And so I just want to draw this idea so you can kind of see it in front of you. I'm a visual learner, so this helps me. It might help you. When we talk about creation, the beginning, we have God, and we have us, and they're together. And the Bible says that it's good. Once he makes us, it says it's very good. Very, very good that this creation was made in the image of God, and God was pleased with what he made. And the language in there is temple language, and it's about humans being together with God. And so we believe that. Most people don't disagree. Somewhere in that story, sin happened and man fell. And so there's a separation between God and man. And so ultimately, then God comes along and says, I'm gonna stay with you, but I'm going to ultimately fix this with my son on a cross and get us back to where it was supposed to be, a new heaven being God's space, a new earth where God and humans are back together the way that they were originally designed to be. And so what we have is we were never supposed to die because sin and death, or sin, we died. We were separated from God. And ultimately, Jesus' life is to get us back into this relationship that we're supposed to have. Now, the question, where are you going to go when you die, lives in a paradigm that really, when studied closely, started within the past 500 years and is a result of a thinking that was happening about 1,700 years ago called Gnosticism. We've talked about that, where there's this idea that when humans die, their disembodied souls are going to go up somewhere. Now, Jewish history, Jewish thought, and the New Testament language is never, ever talking about that. It's talking about a Jesus who physically rose from the dead and says, I rose from the dead, so the promise is you will rise from the dead, and that's going to happen on this earth. So when we ask the question, where do you go when we die, it introduces this new idea that when you die, you either go up to the good place, heaven, or when you die, you go down to the bad place, hell with the flames. So what that does is it basically says to all the people on earth, hey, when you die, you need to accept Jesus so that you get to not go to the bad place and you end up in the good place, which this is never really talked about. It's always about God and us back together. And so what it does is it says God's ultimate plan is to take his project that was messed up and not redeem it, not restore it, not bring it back, but roll it up into a ball, throw it into the trash, and to bring us up into the spiritual existence. But God is not that kind of a God. He's a God of resurrection, restoration, bringing things back together, bringing this gorgeous plan back into its full view. And so the question isn't where are you going to go when you die. The question is, are you going to, as a person, start to live embrace Jesus and enter into the kingdom of God the way that he's going to bring it fully back together in the end. Now, there will be an event. There will be things that happen. The earth will get reshaped and all of that stuff. But we're going to be resurrected like Jesus and be with God in a new heaven and new earth. When we ask this question, it's a fear tactic. It scares people. The New Testament didn't start that way. I mentioned this last week in the book of Acts. The apostles never once go preach a gospel that says, hey, when you die, you're going to end up in the bad place. Unless you accept Jesus, you need to end up in the good place. They go and they preach the gospel. They preach about this. Hey, Jesus started restoring the kingdom now. He started doing this amazing work. If you embrace him as king, if you embrace him, then one day after you die physically, you will resurrect in the kingdom of God on the new heaven, new earth scenario that he originally designed to get us back to where it was. So it kind of uses a fear tactic for the gospel, never God's intention. The other piece is, and John, you can speak to this, is when we weaponize the gospel and we use fear and we ultimately make the question about not any of this life that's lived on earth, but where you go when you die, it basically says, well, none of this matters. None of this matters then. You accept Jesus. You got your fire insurance. You're going to end up in heaven when you die. There's grace, and grace abounds, and we lean into that and go, we'll do whatever. I don't have to look like Jesus or talk like Jesus or act like Jesus. I just know eventually I get to be transformed into Jesus and to fly around and be in the better place. That's not God's plan. God's plan is that the kingdom came, that we can embrace him, that we're starting the process of being transformed now, and we're supposed to bring the kingdom now. I'm sorry, when you read the scriptures and Jesus talks about blessed are the meek, blessed are the peacemakers, for theirs is the kingdom of God. He's not talking about meekness once you get to heaven. Hey, this heaven, hey, blessed are the meek. When you get to heaven, you're going to still need to be meek. Huh? He's saying blessed are the meek here, because theirs is the kingdom of God here. Bring it here, bring it now, and ultimately he'll tie it all up in a bow at the end. So I'm very passionate about hell not being this place of eternal torment. It's never talked about that way. It's talked about as basically, if you get this analogy, humans kind of dehumanized. They were supposed to be in the image of God. When they died, brokenness came in, death, emptiness, physical, spiritual, all this funkiness. The gorgeous plan got marked and marred, and so we debased and dehumanized. Now, ultimately, the picture that we get is that if you never give your life to Jesus, you're going to just kind of remain dehumanized, and you're going to miss the cross, exploration, and explosive idea to move into the way that God originally designed you. Now, this is bad. This is very bad. This is you minus what God has for you. This is you minus the goodness of what it means to be fully human. This is not good.
It's hell.
It's very, very sad. And that's the other part. Talk about sadness, because I keep talking. I'm just jumping all over. Talk about the sad thing, that God's heart is not anger.
Yeah. So when you look at in the scriptures, you know, we think that there's this wrathful God, and that's kind of where we get the idea that he wants to, like, torture those of us who have besmirched his honor or whatever. There's good reasons why you might think that, because there are certain passages that certainly make it seem that way. But there's a lot of passages at the beginning when God's kind of going on his human project of restoration where he shows up to these horrible things that humans are doing, and it says that he's sad. It says that he's heartbroken. He's heartbroken because that's not the way it's supposed to be. And the thing that makes us passionate about this is that we preach that God is going to win. We don't preach that God's going to do plan B. We don't preach that, oh, this world, this human project, that was really bad, so let's go plan B, we'll be spirits up in the sky. We preach that what happened here is what ultimately God's going to restore us to, because we believe that God actually wins. We think he's actually going to win, and he's actually going to restore us to what we were always supposed to be. What happens is that this idea that Joel's talking about, the reason that it damages our preaching of the gospel is because the good news becomes how to avoid the bad thing. So if you got in a car accident tonight, where would you go? Would you spend eternity in hell? Well, that isn't at all telling the story of what we're supposed to become and what happens when we give our lives to Jesus and the Holy Spirit starts to transform us into little Christ. That's what Christian means, little Christ. What starts to happen there? Because this story that Joel just drew, the one with the cross and Jesus and restoration and what you do to bring the kingdom of God now, that means that now what we do actually matters, and what we do for the kingdom of God is going to resurrect with us. It's eternal. So if you're a teacher, the way that you pour into these kids' lives, the way that you shape them and help them and give them confidence and give them the ability to thrive and flourish in this world, that's eternal. That's eternal. That raises with us. That will never be in vain. That's what Paul says. You know, think about like people giving shelter to animals, people giving shelter to the homeless. Those are not just good deeds that we should do because, you know, we got to show our appreciation so that we don't go to hell. But those are eternal things. That is the story of what God is doing, and you are now an actor in it.
John, the mindset that I grew up in, that I was taught, was this plan B thing. And so when you talk about, you remember when I had that moment where I like came to tears about if you build something for children, if you do something that's really kingdom now, that even if the earth gets destroyed, that somehow in a very real way, God, that matters for eternity. It's very hard to get there. It's very hard to understand because our mindset says, why should we take care of the earth? Why should we take care of the oceans if ultimately God is just going to take this beautiful earth and throw it away and get a new one? Ultimately, what it tells everyone is we're on a soul-saving mission. And that is true, but it's not only true because we're not just souls, we're wholes. God is going to take this earth, shake it up, restore it to the way it was originally designed, along with your resurrected body. What matters now will matter then. And so we have to start living for then. So people get all caught up and, well, wait a minute, the Bible says my citizenship is not on earth, it's in heaven. That's true, but heaven is not somewhere we go. Heaven is going to bring its citizenship here. Okay, there's all this language about up there, down there. These are words that are misinterpreted, misunderstood in terms of just the way that people wrote things. The picture is heaven and earth. So the gospel is Jesus is God and he's the king. He saved you from death and offers you the life that you were supposed to have. That's good news, man. Live it now. Bring it now. Do what you were supposed to do as an image bearer now. That's beautiful. Yeah. Oh, beautiful. I'm not supposed to say beautiful. I said it. Wow. I was trying to use synonyms for beautiful because we both say that so much.
Lovely.
Lovely.
Gorgeous.
Charming. Pretty. Mesmerizing.
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah.
So you had other ones loaded.
Yeah, I did. Yeah. Oh, you have a question. Go ahead. Right, yeah. What happens after you die? Right, for people that don't embrace.
That don't start living for the kingdom now, what happens to those people?
So if you're not living for the kingdom and maybe you haven't accepted the person of Jesus, the scriptures teach us that choice matters. So if people are not choosing God, then at some point there's going to be a new phase of things. And if they haven't chosen God, then they're not going to be included in the kingdom. But that's even bad language. They've chosen not to be included in the kingdom. And so, yeah, I mean, we want to say that they're going to go here, but really they're just not going to be in the kingdom. And Dallas Willard said that hell is the best that God can do for those who don't choose him. So it's not necessarily what we thought it was. In some ways, it might be worse. And it's very important that you choose the kingdom of God. People need to know that. We are not universalists. John and I believe that there is a line of demarcation in your choice in your faith life. That's why what matters now. See, think about it. If it's all about just where I go when I die, and I don't have to, and it's only works oriented, like, and we're not saying that it's salvation by anything other than grace, but ultimately, man, if it's just all about, hey, I get a gift, I get to go somewhere, I don't have to live this thing out, we believe that's detrimental to the whole idea of accepting Jesus, bringing the kingdom now, and bringing that kingdom into fruition. If you don't choose that, it matters now, and it matters forever. And that's scary. That's sad. That's not God's plan for humanity. Yes, it's Hades. It's where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. That was an analogous thing that Jesus talked about, this trash heap outside the city. I mean, that's not where you want to be. That's not inside the kingdom. This matters. Embrace it now and forever. God does not send people to whatever this is outside. People choose not to have him. Will they have a choice after certain events? Maybe.
It doesn't say.
They might have a choice, but people will make a choice. Now, then, in between, people are choosing. If they don't choose, they lose the kingdom of God. Does that answer that? Okay. Yep.
Okay. Cool. So
we have to go. We have such important questions to answer.
They're going
to
play the wrap it up music here in a second.
Yeah, I know.
All right. So one of the other questions that we got from a lot of people. And so, by the way, this, we understand, this is a lot. So please fill out your Connect card. We'd love to sit with you. We'd love to talk with you.
John will meet with anyone.
And so the next question that was interesting, because it's a little bit of a deviation from, like, these theological topics that we've kind of been covering, hermeneutics, how to read the scriptures, all that kind of stuff. Multiple people actually asked a question about how do you hear from God? Which is a really, really good question. How do you know that God is speaking to you? How do you know what God wants for your life? I have a job decision that I have to make. How do I know what God wants me to do? I try to pray. How do I know that's God's voice and not my conscience? How do I know that's God's voice and not my cultural conditioning? How do I know what I'm supposed to do? How do I know what God wants for me and whether or not that's his voice that's speaking?
So I think it's the same as how do I know what John wants? How do I know what John wants? How do I know what John wants
comparison.
Me to do? If I go to Steak and Shake and I go, what does John want?
Fresco melt.
Fresco, how do I know? He's told me, I know him, we've talked about it, so I know what he wants. So really, when we're talking about how do I hear from God, what we want to know is, what does God think? What does God want? What is God about?
Yeah.
And the way that we figure that out is by knowing God. So really, we have all these things that we want in our lives. Where should I move? How should I spend my money? Who should I marry? Whatever. How many kids should we have? Should we? Whatever. All these questions that we will have. How do I handle this situation? Ultimately, I believe that's where the confusion comes in. Because what God wants is he wants you. He wants you. He wants an intimate, conversational, consistent relationship with you. And when you come to him, a lot of times the things you want or the questions you have are what draw you to him. And so we think it's about getting those answers, and he's going, I just want this. And then the outcome of getting closer to God is knowing God. I've spent time with God.
Yeah.
I've talked to God. I've heard from God. How? Because I sought him out. So sometimes the most desperate moments in your life are going to be that thing that bring you closer to God. And you think it's about fixing the desperate. And God's going, I just wanted you. And I can deal with the desperate too. But you may not get your desperation fixed. You may just get closer to God. And so ultimately, we get close to God by reading the scriptures. Okay, that's the first one. The scriptures teach us so much. We have to know how they speak, the language that they speak. John did a brilliant message about that last week. A gorgeous message.
Beautiful.
It was mesmerizing. Stunning.
Thank you.
Charming.
That's a good one. Stunning is good.
And he did that. So we learn his language. We're learning about God. We see how God acted here. We see how God acted here. We see how God acted here. We know, he likes the Fresco milk. He likes it. We know what God is, so we kind of know what he thinks about our circumstances. Yeah. I'm sorry, I just said circumstances. That was a weird way to say circumstances. But we know about God. So then we talk to him. We pray. The Holy Spirit teaches us. We start to learn the voice of God. And then when we think we hear from God, now this is something I didn't get into last time. We have to be careful not to do what I call the spiritual stiff arm. And this is what we do. When we have something we're trying to figure out and we think God speaks to us, you know what we say? We say, God told me. And what that means is you're telling anyone else that has any interest or questions about what you're doing that the decision is final. God told me. God told me, so I just go, oh, I already know. I already know the answer. And I could do that with anything. I could say, well, God told me to get tattoos on my face like Post Malone. And then you all go, no, he didn't, Joel. And I go, well, yes, he did. He spoke to me. And you go, wait a minute. Anything, we can push people out. But really what we're doing is supposed to bring people in. Right? So when we just tell people, God told me so, we're moving the scriptures out of the equation, and we're moving wise counsel out of the equation. God speaks to us through his scriptures and through wise people that know him as well. So you don't get to walk through life and just have an emotion and go, well, God told me, so I get to do it. God is going to tell you what he's told people in the past. God is going to tell you what his will is like it is in the New Testament. God's will is for us to pray without ceasing. You think you can go along and say, you know what? I just have this individual faith with God, and he told me I don't have to pray. I'm going to go, no, he didn't. He didn't tell you that. That's not consistent with the God I know. That's not consistent with the character found in the scriptures. That's not consistent with what it says in the New Testament. So we don't get to use the Holy Spirit to just do whatever we want. The Holy Spirit is something we have to learn to hear. We learn it by learning what God has said, who he is in the past, by praying, and then having other people in our lives, in community, and then we go, oh, okay, God is telling me this specific thing. He's not always going to fix your problem. He's not always going to tell you. He might just want a closer, more intimate relationship with you. And ultimately, when you know him, you go, I can't fix my circumstances, but I feel different about where I am. I said this last service, and someone said, you got to say that again. Some of us want to know where to go to college, what job to take, who to marry, what house to buy, what car to buy. We go, God, I want God's will. Should I keep my job? I don't like my job. I want to know all these specific things. And here's something that was told to me when I was in getting ready to go either to Ohio State or to seminary. My young life leader looked at me and he said, you know what, Joel? I don't think God really cares if you go to Ohio State or go to a seminary. And I was like, whoa. He didn't mean that God doesn't care. He meant God will use and be in whatever decision you make. It's not so much where you go, but how you go. Because the will of God is for you to love people, be gracious, be quick to listen, slow to speak, speech seasoned with salt. The will of God is clear. If we just did all the things that he said, love your neighbor as yourself, be slow, be kind, be faithful, be gentle. If we did all that, we can take that anywhere the world is and bring the goodness of God into the world. That's the will of God. That's his will. He wants you to take who he is and what it means to be a Christ follower wherever you go. So now, does that mean sometimes God doesn't give us specific things? I think he does sometimes. I think he doesn't sometimes. But you need to know that you, as a Christ follower, can take who you are into any situation and do what God wants you to do. You can be who he wants you to be.
Yeah, we have a fear, I think, a lot of times where we have this decision to make and we think that we can make the wrong decision. Should I take this job? Should I stay? And we think that if we stay, then we might be doing something that's outside the will of God. And so we put this pressure on ourselves. How do I know what I'm supposed to do? And I would say that there are certainly times where I think God does push and pull us to specific things. But in general, the whole story of the Bible is about people choosing the wrong thing over and over and over and over. And does God still work?
And how God is faithful.
He is.
So I was talking to someone after the last service. If you pray, if your whole mindset is, well, I just want to know, God, should I move to California? Should I take that job in California? And then you go, he gave me a piece about it. And then you go there, and something catastrophic happens. Now what? God messed up? You see, we can't base the direction of our lives on whether or not the circumstances go well. It's all about who you journey with. God wants an intimate connection with you, and he will never leave you or forsake you. And sometimes the will of God is for you to go through something that seems unimaginable with a very imaginable, reliant, wonderful God who can restore and help you in anything. Yeah. It's hard to wrap all that up. That's why the moving target is get to know God. If you go through life just trying to figure out how to be successful or how to be comfortable or how to fix everything and make everything great, you're missing the point. Greatness is being close to God. That's what it's about. That's your aim. Make that your passion. Go after that, and the rest is cream cheese.
I don't know what that means. All right, so We talked about praying. We talked about the scriptures. We talked about the Holy Spirit, right? These are places where we focus individually, where God moves us, where we find him, where we can talk to him. One thing that we don't often actually emphasize in the Western Protestant church, but I think is to our detriment, is community.
Yeah.
Where does God speak? Where has God always spoken? In communities of followers, in communities of believers, in churches. Right? And so, you know, we have to make sure that that is a place where we go, that we have to hear the voice of God, wise counsel from people that we trust. If you think about the way that Judaism and then Christianity was done until 500 years ago, it was always done in groups of people. There's no such thing as a printing press, so nobody had a Bible. Right? There was scrolls that the churches had. There were letters that the churches had. And it was always read in a community of people. It was always talked about in a community of people. We are communal beings, and so it's just how it's set up. Some of us, we don't have that connection. And we find that our spiritual lives seem to constantly be confused. And part of the reason why is because we don't have that grounding of community. The way that we're always supposed to experience God is with other people and amongst other people. And so if you think about, like, you know, we're going to talk about this at Become, but if you think about the way that we do our church, we do large group, right, which is Sunday morning. It's what we're doing right now. And then we have 430 or so adults in small groups. And your kids go back, and they have a large group experience, and then they have a small group experience. And then they go on to middle school, Boom, and Boom has a large group experience and a small group experience. And our high schoolers, same thing, large group, small group, groups. Right? Because that is exactly the place where I think God shows up most strongly and most clearly in communities.
You know, one of the funniest things in church world is people that get the Matthew 18 thing taken out of context. They'll say, like, where two or more are gathered, there he is. Mm-hmm. And it's like, oh, well, God's not here unless there's two of us. That's not true. God's there even if there's one. The point is that the truth is more clear when more people show up.
Yeah.
When more people show up, then it's like, oh, ooh, that means that's true. So we're looking for truth. We're looking for what to do. You want to know what to do? Pursue God intimately in Bible reading and prayer. Pursue other godly people and ask them what they think. When all those things sit around the campfire, truth comes up. Direction comes out. What you need comes forth. You figure it out. That's the point of that passage. It's like we're trying to find the truth.
Yeah.
Where there's two or three or four that are all seeking God, we'll probably find more of the truth. You're not going to find the truth alone. You might hear from God and you're with God. He never is, you know, outside of you being alone. You need to, I mean, how could you only have God if you're alone when it says that, when Jesus says, if you're going to pray, go pray by yourself? Of course, that's not what that means, right? Sorry, I just, all right. So, we got to go.
Yeah, that's how you hear from God.
That's it, man. Boom. That's it. That's final, too. There's nothing else to say about that. We are going to start another series next week, guys. We've been in this season of learning, and hopefully you've been tracking with us, reading through the book of Mark. It's the first time we've ever done a series that's tied to a reading that we've done through the scriptures as a church.
As a church.
So we're doing a series on the book of Mark called Toss It to the Dogs. You do not want to miss this. We're super excited about it. It starts next week. And other than that, let me pray for you guys. Again, remember the diagram. We have different ideas. Let's share those ideas. Draw close to one another. Learn. Be curious. Remember that we're supposed to major on the majors and that we're brought together in the name of Jesus. That's what unifies us. So let me pray for you guys, and then we'll go out of here. God, thank you so much for this room, for the truth that we're all learning as we pursue you and try to understand you. Thank you for the mystery that is you, that we constantly need to move further towards you to understand, and we get to chase you, and we get to experience how mesmerizing you are and how gorgeous you are. We love you. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
See you guys.
Bye.
Like a coat that I sold in the summer, and I'm cold and I want you back. Want you back.